Hello, it's Chris from Open Mind Space. It is Tuesday, August 19th, 2014, and tonight's show will be on the Voluntary Virtues Network. And what I'd like to talk to you about tonight is the kinds of mental games that are played in regards to statism and all of the kinds of controlled opposition. So not only is statism and government in general a mindfuck, but so too is much of the alternative. I think much of that by design and much of it just by the fact that there's just a lot of idiots out there doing things that are just a big circle jerk. So many of you are probably quite keen on all of the sophistry that goes on behind statism. All of the just pure shit that they use in order to fuck with people's heads. You've got all of the propaganda and media and movies and shows constantly giving you a really bizarre idea about the world with the, of course, in most cases, with the government at the center of our lives. You've got all these television shows where something happens and then you've got just vans full of government agents pull up with black uniforms on and weapons, and they come and save the day. And you know, they're here. Any problem that occurs, they're able to solve it. They're able to solve it. Any evil that occurs in the world, they're here. They recognize it. They'll catch it, and they'll stop it and save humanity. Well, you know, if you've unplugged somewhat, you realize that a lot of that is propaganda, and that while they may play a role in society in stopping certain threats to their, what I would call, tax livestock, they certainly do that, yeah. But they also do a lot of harm in the process, and that's been pretty well documented. So, how do they fuck you? You know, besides the besides all the stupid movies and all this other nonsense, especially action movies, you've got the schooling that people go to. You know, you go, you spend all this time at school. They tell you the same lies for 12 some odd years, and then if you want to, you go to college and you learn some more, maybe a little more job-related skills, but also mixed in with some more lies as well. Required, of course. Those are required courses. And, you know, if you're really a bullshit artist, you might go into history or philosophy or something like that and learn a really redacted version of history or philosophy that could be very useless in actually changing anything. So there's that. That's certainly a very important mechanism for controlling your mind. And then there's all the just systematic ways that things are controlled by, of course, having a single currency in your society that is coined by either the government itself or one of its friends, and tightly controlling the issuance of credit and money, and fixing interest rates and various prices, and regulating industries in order to ensure that the parties who are lobbying the government hardest, generally the most entrenched and established players, are going to have an advantage over any sort of upstarts. Also, licensure of professionals, which I've already talked about. How you've got a third of all the professionals in the United States, for example, must have some kind of bullshit license from the government in order to operate. I mean, you've got to get a license to be able to give somebody a back rub. Why is that? Is that because they're afraid you might jerk somebody off? And then, oh my God, they've got to have cops go around to make sure that people aren't jerking one another off in massage parlors. That's incredibly valuable to maintaining the fabric of society. We've got to make sure these Chinese massage parlors don't have people in there jerking guys off for an extra $20. That would be chaos. We've got to repress people's sexuality. You know, that's another thing. On the one hand, you have the repression of sexuality, which is just fucking disastrous. And then on the other hand, you have all these idiotic ways that it's encouraged. Oh, man, just thinking about this is depressing. And then you've got, the counterculture. There's been, a lot of this is really, when you start talking about the counterculture, you get really controversial really quick. And I don't know what to believe about some of the stuff, but I do know that there's certainly preponderance of evidence to show that many of the key figures in the counterculture were in some way affiliated with the government, either through some kind of CIA affiliation or various institutes and organizations that are associated with them. There appears to have been, and it's smart, these guys aren't fools. What could be easier than buffaloing a bunch of shallow, drug-using people into believing, who don't have any sort of critical thinking skills, but into believing damn near anything and being able to focus their attention on bullshit rather than on anything that might actually change society and get in the way of powerful people. Well, you encourage them to do shitloads of drugs. And you, I don't know, I mean, a lot of it you don't even have to do anything. I mean, these people are just going to jerk off, for the whole existence, or at least for, their younger years. And they'll just get burned out on all these drugs. And of course, the drugs are encouraged by a variety of factors, either by direct importation through Air America of many of these drugs, or by the fact that they're contraband and therefore there's going to be a great premium on selling things that are contraband. So there's a large profit margin there, and especially if you can be protected and let through. Play your cards right and manage your risk to where you can do it without getting caught very easily. So you create a lot of drug use in your society, and some of them are not so bad, but some of these drugs are pretty damaging to the mind. And I think some of them that are considered not so bad are probably not so great for people who are younger to be using. Making shit illegal, it's kind of like banning a book. Even if it's not a good idea to do something, you make it illegal and people are going to want to do it. That's the nature of many of in our society, especially the kind of countercultural rebellious sorts. You know, you start making cocaine, marijuana, you know, the list is always expanding. You make it illegal, and then there's a certain group of people in society that say, that's illegal. There must be, that must be good. That must be something I would enjoy, because I know that the government doesn't want me to have fun, so shit, I better try that. Whereas in some cases, I'm sure, you know, things, many people wouldn't even be aware of these things if it weren't illegal, if there wasn't some kind of government focus on these things. I think drugs would be much less of a part of our society. I mean, I think obviously things like alcohol have been around for ages, and some form of drug is going to be used by people. People enjoy having some form of drug use, at least certain people do. And there's a variety of reasons for that. I actually learned some really interesting information from, I believe it was Stefan Molyneux, when he was talking about why certain kinds of people are addicted to drugs. And the reason why this is because, generally speaking, and I know you're going to laugh because this is what he says a lot of times, they had a fucked up childhood, honestly. They were neglected by their parents. They were maybe hit by their parents. You know, whatever happened to fry their little brain to where they didn't have natural kind of regulating mechanisms in it. And then, you know, so if you were to put a number, you know, as far as their little meter of how good they feel, you know, they're usually at, on a scale of 0 to 100, they're at like 20 on, you know, normal time. Whereas maybe your average person who might have been actually raised decently, they'd be on more like a 70 or 80. And then they do the drug, you know, whatever it is, heroin, cocaine, whatever, and it brings them up to a 80 or 90. But the thing is, they stop doing it and it goes right back down to 20. Whereas your average person, you know, they're at 70 or 80 and it maybe brings them up to 100. You know, I'm just pulling these numbers out of my ass, but that's the basic idea of it is if you feel really, really shitty because you've just had a horrible history and you've never dealt with the shit and you've never fixed the problem, then these drugs are a quick fix for you. And so you can put people into these schools, these shitty public schools. You can take the parents away from them by having all the incentives kind of built around, you know, shuffling your kids into these damned schools and going to work all the time so that you don't have a parent around for your child. And the child ends up fucked up, and then they end up being, quite often, you know, sometimes they end up going through okay, but it's not uncommon for them to get bullied and harassed in these schools and mistreated by their parents because the parents barely know them. They're raised by the fucking state. These kids are raised by the fucking state, and they often end up becoming drug addicts, and then all the black market stuff that grows up around it, there's not a legitimate way of handling conflicts and regulating it through the market as might be possible in a more open system where you could actually have legal remedies to things. And so there's a lot of violence, and this violence destroys entire neighborhoods and entire societies, and it ends up being kind of overcome by drugs. And then you've got, of course, welfare. That's a big mind fuck right there. And it's, of course, well-intended by quote-unquote liberals who don't know how to read, apparently. But these liberals believe that this welfare shit is going to help people, and I'm sure that sometimes it does, but the aggregate effect of the welfare is that it creates these underclasses of people who are basically wards of the state who don't have the same kinds of incentives that somebody who maybe has a you know, a career to worry about and that kind of stuff. For instance, I don't know if you've seen any of these videos. There's a videos on YouTube of these hoes, just like they're like at the Waffle House or something, and they're fat and ugly and raunchy, and they're just like beating the shit out of each other right there in the middle of the dining area. And like these women are wearing thongs for some reason, and they have no scruples. No scruples whatsoever. Nothing's going to happen to them for doing what they're doing. I mean, maybe they'll end up put in jail overnight or something like that. But somebody who's got a job and, a livelihood and stuff of their own and a family to worry about that they actually give a shit about, not somebody who's on the dole, they're going to be totally different. They're not going to do that. They may want to. They may be pissed at somebody, but they're going to have to say, well, wait a second. If I go to jail over something, it's going to besmirch my reputation, and then I'm going to end up losing my job, and then I'm not going to be able to support my family, and I'm not going to be able to enjoy the lifestyle that I've built up. And, you know, it kind of regulates itself. It kind of helps control people's behavior. The higher people, the fatter their bellies, not like these fat women who've been eating God knows what, cheap-ass carb food, but quote-unquote, the fatter their bellies, like the more happy they are and content, the more they have to lose, basically, the better they're going to act towards their fellow man. So the mindfuck in this regard is that you create this massive underclass who has nothing to lose and is dependent on the state. And so they may think the state is shit and bitch about it all the time and say, fuck the police and all this kind of stuff. But when it comes down to it, if it were to go away, they would have no means of surviving. And so it does kind of perpetuate it because, honestly, you know, if it were to go away like right now, there'd be a lot of burning cities. Because these people who are dependent on the checks and the frozen burritos and all this kind of stuff, they're not ready for it to go away. And that's why any sort of, you know, transition out of this kind of clusterfuck that is going on right now is going to be a slow one. And it's going to be one that's kind of a grassroots shift, I would think. So obviously, you know, welfare is a huge mindfuck. Public schools. Let's get more into the... I've already gone into the basics of the counterculture. I mean, that could be a 10-hour talk about just all the crazy fucked up shit that's been done to kind of create a counterculture that creates a bunch of moronic idiots who are completely unable to do anything to change society. If you can create the action and then you can create the reaction, you can control the direction of things. And I think it happens both in the culture and in the counterculture. I think they're both kind of controlled in many regards enough to direct the outcome and things and to ensure a level of security that that they prefer. You know, they don't like having people going out and, you know, doing things that aren't somehow controlled and able to be have a lid kept on them. So there's just countless examples of this. I mean, I'm not here to like prove it to you or anything like that, but just to more kind of discuss the topic in general. So let's get into another controversial topic. And this was might rustle some jimmies. And that would be the way that libertarianism and anarchism and those kind of isms have I think they've certainly opened my eyes. Me as a curious individual, I've taken quite well to it. I've enjoyed reading the material. I've enjoyed listening to the people discuss it. And I think there's a lot of great ideas, great philosophies. But ideas aren't everything. You know, how do you actually make the changes that lead to the outcome that you want? I don't think anybody's figured that out yet. And it's not an easy answer. It's not, and the trouble is, it's not the kind of thing that you just snap your fingers and you get what you want. It's something that whatever you do, it's going to have to happen over a very sustained period of time. And you're going to have to be doing it correctly or it's not going to work. So what kind of mindfuck is going on in this sphere? And I don't know, you know, if it's... I think there's certainly a lot of minarchists who are totally dweebs and maybe are just caught up in their whole idea of their constitution and their confounding fathers and all the bullshit that I used to believe. There's probably even videos of me espousing that fucking bullshit. If you look back in my history, I mean, shit, I was once a socialist of sorts. From my college years, I was kind of duped into that for a little while. But, you know, you see all these guys, you know, let's talk, for example, all this stuff about guns. You know, I think, I would advocate that, and if this is just me, this is my preference, and this is something that I think a lot of libertarians would be all gung-ho about. I think it would be great if a very large percentage of the population had a gun on their hip. You know, if they just had a gun on them in somewhere, a gun or a knife or something on them, so that when these kind of crazy things happen, they get stopped, like, right away. Now, there could be some craziness that happens as a result of that, because obviously people do behave a little differently when they're packing heat, especially if they are already kind of fucked up. But I think the net result of it would be that many of those people would be kind of pruned from the tree after a period of time, and that wouldn't be as much of a problem. But there's a lot of people, I think, who are just kind of jerking off, basically. And there's a lot of applauding it, like, oh, that's so great, you're demonstrating your rights and all this kind of stuff. Like, people who go into Chipotle with an assault rifle on them, you know, they've got a little assault rifle on their shoulder in Chipotle or whatever stupid... restaurant there happened to be going to. I saw a video of guys going to Sonic. There was a group of several people who were all carrying assault rifles in Sonic. They went to the Sonic and I think the manager asked them to leave or something like that. Or the people who then wear the assault rifles into Starbucks. You know, I'm not saying that they shouldn't do it. And maybe if there was a person who wanted to rob that place and they saw them, they might choose to not do so. However... my question would be, what do they really hope to accomplish by that? And are they really accomplishing their said ends? Like, do they think that that somehow made them more free? I mean, obviously, they, by virtue of the fact that they've exercised their desire to carry those around and done so successfully and demonstrated that it can be done, yeah, there's something there. But what has often ended up occurring is actually these restaurants have one by one started banning them, started saying, you know, either they do an outright ban or they say, you know, guys, please stop doing that. It's kind of scaring the customers, you know, that kind of thing. I think it's a bit of a little circle jerk, really. It's a bit of an ego thing. I mean, if you want to make a place safer, put a gun on your hip, you know, like a, have a little handgun on your hip, or have it, you know, obscured and concealed in some way or another. Whatever you can get away with. That will have the same effect without freaking people out and causing them to start writing nasty letters to the corporate headquarters or to the owner and getting them to ban weapons on the premises. That kind of thing. Because obviously when they ban weapons on the premises, then you're not free to have them. And then the place is a no-weapon zone, and of course people are much more likely to rob it and to cause havoc over there. I don't know. I mean, when I go out walking, I'm a little bit shocked that this still happens. You see, you go to these shops, and you see all these stupid gun with a X across it on all the quite a number of these places. And I'm thinking, what the fuck do you guys think you're accomplishing by this? You really think that, I mean, obviously this has been gone over time and again. It's really fucking retarded. You know, I guess it's their choice to put that up there, but generally the people inside who work there aren't armed either. So it's kind of a paper tiger, really. Doesn't really mean anything. I don't know what these idiots think they're accomplishing by that, honestly. But, yes, back to libertarianism. So that's one thing, you know, all the focus on, you know, showing off with your guns and all that. Got nothing against, you know, having guns and using them and carrying them and all this kind of stuff. But I question whether or not all this kind of showboating at public places with just ridiculous firearms that are, I don't know, they just don't seem to really have a purpose other than just garnering attention. I wonder what that really does aside from just making you seem to your average couch potato like an extreme individual who they then start to have an attitude about. They're then either they support it or they are violently against it, and it kind of polarizes people and creates drama and conflict and whatnot. Whereas if you just had a maybe a sidearm that you weren't making a big deal about, or a concealed weapon, probably be much less of a big deal. You know, I don't get what the big fucking deal is, you know, about like going around and doing that. There was a while where I was like, yeah, that's great. But, you know, the more I see it, I'm just like, I just question what is being accomplished here, and how this is making anybody any more free. Because it doesn't seem to be having that effect. And yet there's a lot of energy pouring into that. I saw another video. I saw one just the other day, and this is kind of a general attitude I've seen, where these this group of kids, who they're probably all virgins, they tailgated a cop, and I guess one of them was mad about having gotten a speeding ticket. Which, yeah, it's legitimate gripe. Fuck speeding tickets. Fuck all the stupid traffic rules that are revenue generation tickets that they, you know, give out. But these guys actually tailgated a cop, and they were like, "We're gonna get this cop. We're gonna pull him over and give him a ticket." And the cop got, and you know, they followed him for a while, and cop got into the turn lane, and it was a double turn lane, and they got over to the left-hand side of the cop, and they started, you know, raising their voice to the guy and cop rolled his window down and they were like telling him that he was speeding and that they had just gotten a ticket. And that badges don't grant extra rights and, you know, all these slogans that they probably constantly use. And hey, true, yeah, badges, nobody has any fucking rights. So what? I don't understand why rights are even discussed. But yeah, badges and rights. And they said, we need you to pull over here so that we can give you a citation. And, well, I guess that's a nice rebellious little thing to do, to say, pull over here and get a citation. But, well, fortunately for them, you know, obviously the cop is not going to do it. He's not going to let them give him a citation. Because they don't have enough guns to enforce it. So it's kind of a impotent little gesture to get attention. And actually, while they were saying that, they were saying the names of all their websites and things of that sort. And so the cop, you know, he said a few things and then he drove off. And that's actually probably the best outcome they could have hoped for in that circumstance. Because a number of these people, I applaud their intent and their desire to defy the state, but doing things like that probably makes the cop think that you're really annoying and want to, I don't know, maybe like be harder on people who are doing, you know, who are activists. But also there is a chance, as you've probably seen from these videos of what police do, that the cop could then say, well, I'm going to pull your ass over. You were actually right behind me, so I know what speed you were going. And I'm going to find some sort of technicality to get you on. Or we might search your car and find drugs. Or we might just beat the crap out of you or taser you right here. Or kill you. I mean, these guys, many of them are mentally ill. There's probably many who are just as sane as you or I by any rational standard, as far as such a thing could be measured. But many of these guys are like, you know, shell-shocked vets. They've been killing people. They've crossed the line. You know, they've been shot at and they've killed people, and they've done so possibly foreign lands and on domestic soil. And when you do stuff like that, you didn't make yourself any freer. I mean, yeah, you maybe defied the usual way of things, broke some social norms and conventions, didn't just keep your head down like a sheep. There is some certainly some kudos there. But at the end of that exchange, you were no freer than before. So you didn't abolish the state by doing that. Now, maybe if people were not taking the cops seriously and they all were armed and the cops didn't have an overwhelming way of amassing force on anybody who defied them, then that could possibly be a different situation. But still, that's the way it is at this point. They're walking around with sidearms and they have a radio on, and if you defy them, they can call in lots of other people with sidearms, or they can call in, you know, obviously military-grade hardware, and they can crush your ass. And that's just the reality of the current situation, and it's going to take a long time, if ever, to unwind that. And those kind of stunts, they're funny and they're cute and all that kind of stuff, but quite often it results in those poor kids going to jail and being fined and then supporting the state through a bunch of fines. I once talked to somebody for a little bit on Skype. I think I had met her through a dating site. I searched for anarchist and I found like one person. on, I think it was OkCupid. There's probably more, but at the time, that was all I really found. And it was kind of a hippie girl, had dreadlocks, and she was really passionate. I think I got to talk to her once, and she was all, like, focused on her battle with the state. So what happened, I guess, is she had a ticket. And it was probably some ridiculous bullshit, as most tickets are. I guess all tickets, really. For $100 or something like that. 100 or two. And what she did is, she, I believe, spent hours and hours writing on $1 bills. So it was probably $200 or something like that. But she spent loads and loads of time writing on these $1 bills. And I think maybe even like folded them up into little piggies or something like that. I forget. But she spent just a bunch of her time doing this. And then went into the court to pay the fine at the cashier. And I think the whole time she was there, she was, shall I say, it was almost like the kind of witnessing that a really, really fundamentalist Christian does to, I don't know if you've ever had the pleasure of dealing with a really, really, really fire and brimstone, like Southern Baptist fundamentalist Christian who thinks that you are just going to perish in the lake of fire if you don't do everything that they tell you to do. Well, it was kind of like this. And she was like, I don't know what the word is, just witnessing, say, so to speak, the religious truth of what she was trying to say. And trying to convert these statists to get them to throw down their badges and walk out of the courtroom. As if that's all it's going to take, just they need a little convincing and that they would just then walk out and stop being employees of the government, even though they probably worked there for like 15 years. And anyways, she did so. She went to the cashier. She probably, from their perspective, irritated the shit out of them. And they said, we can't take this. It's probably illegal. They probably were supposed to take it anyways. But she clearly, when you annoy an agent of the government, especially at a place like a courthouse, they have a bit of leeway. And they can easily call over armed men to either kick your ass out or throw you in a cell or something like that. So she's like in the belly of the beast. You know, it's like being in a shark's mouth and just poking the roof of the mouth, poking the cheeks, and hoping that the shark doesn't swallow you. Well, after a little bit of it, they sent over, you know, armed thugs to ask her to leave. They tried to ask her. They asked her to leave several times, and she did the whole, you know, just the spiel over and over. There's video footage of it. I don't know if I can find it anymore, but she did the spiel and just kept on doing it and doing it. They were just like, "Come on, let's go. Let's get out. Let's go to the door." They walked her over the door. She stood at the door and just kept on going with the spiel, probably reinforcing their whole desire to be cops, honestly. Because now they see these activists for liberty as raving lunatics and who just don't know how to... You know, that's how psychology often works, is you don't... If you don't talk to somebody the right way, or maybe however you talk to them, you're just going to reinforce their own views quite often. So just pitching an argument, or you can have the greatest argument or discussion in the world, and people who are really set in their ways, they're just going to dig in even harder. It's just the way it is. Anyways, they pretty much, they gave her a bunch of chances to leave, and she didn't take them, unfortunately. And they then arrested her and kind of somewhat, like, they didn't fuck her up or anything, but didn't look like fun. So now she went from having a fine to now having a fine plus all sorts of new legal problems. So now her freedom is to, well, she's probably past all this by now, but that really doubled up many times. I would say that's like double down. That's like doubling down about 10 times, because then you've got all these serious, you go from having a little fine to having, serious, quote-unquote serious crimes, charges against you. And now she's, at this point in the state, in the situation, she, gets, I guess, put into a cell for a little while and charged with a bunch of shit. And then there's a bunch of court dates. And then she's dealing with this guy. I don't even need to give his name. I'm not here to dick around with anyone in particular. But she's dealing with this guy and fighting it in a certain way where she thinks she can win. And it's one of those kind of things where if you fuck up, you could end up in jail for like 10 years, fighting it in the manner that that they are. I mean, it's ballsy, and sometimes you can have victories, but ultimately, this court system is not fair, and it's not just, and you're in the belly of the beast when you're dealing with these fuckers. And so I guess the point I'm trying to make is I don't understand why many of our buddies here who are, care about freedom and becoming, freer individuals, why they go so far, so to such great lengths to entangle themselves with the court system and to become caught up in the web of the court system, which is going to snarl at them and going to, in many cases, chew them up and spit them out and take their money and take their time and take their lives and have a sword hanging over their head for months. That's not my idea of freedom. Now, cowering and trying to avoid ever getting in trouble, I'm not advocating that as well, but there's the responsible assumption of risk that I think is unknown to many of these people. When I have a fine that I have that is levied upon me, whether it be a speeding ticket or I've gotten fines from the property, from the inspector that goes around the little clown car and tries to find code violations and things like that. I haven't had it happen very much, fortunately. I've had maybe one speeding ticket, one moving violation, a couple of parking tickets, and one building code citation. I, look into it and I see, is there any way I can get out of this? Is there any way, sometimes just showing up in court is enough to get out of it and, saying you want to challenge it. And then, of course, also weighing, like, what is it going to cost me to try to get out of this thing? Is it really going to be a net benefit? Is it really going to pull the steam out of the beast's sailboat? And, like, for instance, I had a stupid-ass ticket for not moving over when a copper was on the side of the road, and there was no logical reason to move over. It was purely because there was a law about it, and there was a fine associated with it. because that cop wasn't anywhere near the side of the road. There was no rational reason to move over. Yet the fucker pulled me over, and he was very polite and kind, and I took the damn ticket, and I looked it up. I was pissed. It pissed me off for a few weeks when that happened. Really, that was the real cost to me, is having to be pissed off about this stupid-ass thing that happened and just having to have such a ridiculous thing happen. And I looked it up, and I pondered going. I even talked to my lawyer. I pondered going to the courthouse, which actually, unfortunately, it was like a county over, so I'd have to drive like an hour to get there. And I realized that most likely I'm going to go to the courthouse. They're going to uphold the fine. And then I'm going to have wasted like a half day to a day. I would have to take a day off work plus pay a fine. So I just paid the damn thing on my credit card. You know, I've gotten so many tickets driving that stretch of the road, it's likely I would have gotten another ticket, quite honestly. You know, that's the only road stretch of road I've ever gotten. I had a speeding ticket on that, you know, a few years prior. So, I mean, there's certain stretches of road that the cops sit on. And, you know, the more you get out on the road, the more you become cannon fodder for them. I mean, that's another thing is, like, to me, part of freedom is knowing how to avoid shitheads, whether it be in the private world, you know, in the personal sphere, or in the government. And one great way to be under the government's control is to be out driving on the road, to be out doing a bunch of activities that cause you to drive all over the place. If you can find a way to, you know, like live near where you work, and which is great anyways, really, and to have you know, activities that are in the area and all that kind of stuff, if that's something you can manage to coordinate and be happy with and all that, then, hey, more power to you. Or if you can walk, ride your bike, whatever, you know. The less time you spend out on that road, the less likely you are to be harassed by these people and to feed into their revenue grid. And, you know, the less taxable vehicles you have and that sort of thing, that's a lesson I've learned the hard way. Is, you know, got a couple of vehicles, and now I'm paying, you know, like $500,000 every year just to, for the privilege of driving these vehicles on the government's roads, and, of course, all the gas taxes and that kind of stuff. Fortunately, they're hybrid vehicles, but nonetheless, it's expensive as shit. And anyways, I don't want to go too far down that particular tangent, but suffice it to say, one last example. The whole Adam Kokesh loading the gun, you know, obviously there's nothing wrong with that. You know, I think it's ridiculous that that they've managed to make stupid laws about that sort of thing. But by the same token, that cost him dearly in many ways. Got him a shitload of attention, which I think was the whole purpose of it. But it cost him dearly in terms of, you know, spending time in prison. I don't know the full gauntlet that was laid down on him, but nonetheless, I mean, obviously, it's their system. You know, your body is being put into shackles and put into their dungeon, basically, over these ridiculous things. And so if you can avoid that, boy, that would be nice, because there's a lot more you can do outside of the prison. You know, that's why I and many other people pay taxes, because if you want to be able to work your chosen profession and earn a living that way, if you don't have some way of doing it under the table or outside of the sphere of their influence, then you end up having to pay taxes, because if you don't, your information is likely, most employers at least, they report the information directly to them, so you've got all this info in their databases, and it's a poop shoot for them to come in, take whatever you have, you know, especially if you have like a house or something like that, or a car, because you got the tags registered. If you got a house, obviously that's easy as hell for them to put a lien on and or take. And then, of course, there's the really crappy possibility of getting put in jail for years. You know, like the Ed and Elaine Brown people who they had themselves a nice little business and they thought they would be able to not pay the income tax and then further thought that they'd be able to sit out a standoff with the U.S. Marshals. And eventually, you know, they could have gotten shot. They could have had a lot of things happen to them. Eventually, somebody dressed as, you know, somebody who was impersonating a supporter, I guess you could say, came in and arrested them. And then they got put into the jail for 10 years. So they're not very free as a result of that. And their whole livelihood is destroyed. And that's horrible. And it's a despicable thing. It's horrible that that occurred. But they, in many ways, did not manage their risk in order to be able to remain free. It's horrible that guns are put to people's heads and that these stupid-ass laws are written and that these gutless people enforce them. But that is the reality of the current circumstance. And so I think that it's important to, when one is contemplating what they want to do, to figure out what might actually produce benefits for them and for those that they want to benefit. You know, because this is a really nebulous, freedom, you know, is a very nebulous thing. Could mean a lot of things. Statists think they know what freedom is. They think freedom is saluting the flag and joining the army and having a ball game and watching the television and voting. It's a relative concept, you know? It's not the same to everybody. You need to figure out what it is to you. What does that mean to you? What does it mean to be free? Does the government have to not exist for you to at least be free in your own mind and your own skin? Do you have to go and get yourself put in jail to feel like you're doing something to help your idea of what freedom is? And if so, what is this idea of freedom? And how is that going? How is that helping anything? You know, as I've kind of discussed in some of these other videos, I've personally started to, it's been a long road. I've been kind of had one foot in this door for quite a while, working more on self-development. Like I've been very strongly focused on a lot of these external events that occur, you know, like current events and, the philosophies and economics of liberty and anarchism and all that kind of stuff. And I still do focus on that a bit. But, you know, I've been getting more into how the hell can I just be happy here in my own skin? You know, I'm not one of those kind of people who's just going to, like, put my head up my ass. You know, who when I become more comfortable and happy and relaxed and content, you know, through meditation, tai chi, yoga, whatever, you know, practices I choose to do, I'm not going to be one of those kind of idiots who just puts my head up my ass. You know, I'm still going to pay attention to what's going on and take action where I feel it appropriate and things like that. I'm not just going to pretend that nothing is happening, that I'm just perfectly happy with the state of things. Because I'm not. I have empathy for my fellow man, and I hate to see thugs running society. But I also hate to see thugs kind of controlling my relationship to myself. I hate to see, you know, there's all this shit going on and it sucks, and I'm not pleased about it, but I really don't want that to dictate my inner life. Because I know that's not necessary. I know that I can still do things that affect other people, that maybe affect the whole, you know, the fate of society in some tiny way, at least, in my own little minuscule contribution. You know, I see particularly like the way that I bring my children up as being my main contribution, but also the example I set is something I'm always working on, is trying to set a better example. And heck, if you can get people to be free internally, inside their own heads and their own bodies and their own skin, if you can get them to let go of old shit that they've been, that's been keeping them down, that's been preventing them from growing as an individual, that's been creating tension in their body and mind and spirit, and just lowering their quality of life. If you can help raise people's quality of life, that goes a long way to solving these other problems. Because why do people cling on things like statism and all the dumbass things that people do to try to fix it that don't do anything? It gives them a sense of self. It gives them a sense of accomplishment, a sense of purpose. But it's a very fake sense. You know, obviously, you know, people are free to do whatever floats their boat, but some things are going to have more of a effect than others on their overall well-being. I could spend 4 hours watching videos on Facebook or television shows or football or watching videos of cops beating people up or whatever. Or I could spend 4 hours, like, I don't know, maybe like I could clean my house, I could, you know, work on my garden, I could practice some yoga to help my body out so I wouldn't be a fat fuck. Could meditate maybe so that my mind's nice and clear, so that the time I do spend doing other things is really, I'm really sharp and able to do well. I could grow some sprouts. I could, the list is endless, you know? Yet I find that there's a number of ways that one can be a couch potato, and a lot of times those things are addictive. I find myself caught up in it quite often. You know, I just sit down and get on Facebook and start exploring things. And before you know it, the night's over. I wasted a couple hours tonight. Thank goodness I got down and cleaned up the kitchen, at least at some point. But I spent a couple hours just fiddle farting around. To me, it's a lot of it's just joking nowadays. Like, I don't take a whole lot seriously anymore. But, you know, I spent... wasted at least 2-3 hours. I could have been doing something like that might better myself in a more significant way than just farting around online. You know, I'm not trying to say that one should not do those things. One should not spend time online. Obviously, I'd be a hypocrite. But I'm just saying I've recognized in my own self that obviously taking it to the excess is going to prevent, got an opportunity cost, you know? I mean, if you're busy trying to pull cops over and, you know, running around with your gun on, your assault rifle out and dealing with all the pissed off people and all the nonsense that goes along with that, possibly getting shot by cops who think you're out doing something, you know, you're not going to be, hey, getting that giant gut taken care of. You know, like there's a lot of fat people in this society. I think, I don't know if there's if there's more fat people who are libertarians or not. I'm not going to go there, but there's a shitload of fat people in our society, and many of those people could control that and help themselves if they would do something to really self-examine. And I know from my own experience, I was a little overweight, actually, during my younger years, during my time in school, actually. I used to drink a lot of soda and eat a lot of junk food and that kind of stuff. And I had love handles, and I was probably, I don't know, I wasn't extremely overweight, but I had friends who were. And I know for a fact that their diet was just horrendous, and that if they had changed it, they would have been much better off, and they probably wouldn't have had to go get gastric bypass surgery or anything like that that's terribly invasive to one's overall health and well-being. But that would just be a matter of, you know, taking some time, taking some of this time away from the one-way, you know, communications, or, you know, the internet, obviously it's two ways, but taking some of this time away from these often very low-profit endeavors to maybe do something for yourself, to maybe spend, you know, what is it? I think it's like 30 minutes is about, or 1 hour, that's what it was. 1 hour is roughly, of course, this is not precise. 1 hour is roughly about 5% of your day. So even if you do a lot of this stuff to, you know, enjoy yourself, why not take an hour of that time, do something to purely to develop yourself, to keep yourself fit and in shape and mentally sound and clear of mind, you know, to balance your mind, body, and spirits, and be strong in that regard. Because I guarantee you, if you did that, all the other time would be far more effective. I know from my own experience that, you know, all this time that I spend doing things, which I'm really glad that I got the process streamlined down to where I do it for, you know, several hours a week now. It used to be I would maybe do it 1 hour a week, maybe not even do it at all. But now that I've got it down to where I'm practicing some kind of self-development for, I don't even know anymore. It's getting up above 10 hours at this point in time. Yeah, it's probably about 10 hours. Now that I'm doing that, a lot of my body pain is gone. You know, a lot of my stress is gone. I have a way of releasing the stress that does build up very easily. So I'm relaxed. I'm calm. My mind is stilled. I'm thinking much more clearly. When things do upset me, they don't last as long. And I'm not letting that whole shitty zeitgeist of statism soil me and destroy me from the inside. You can't let that shit destroy you and take over you. You can't just become the other side of the coin, you know, because then you're kind of the controlled opposition in a way. You know, if these things that you disapprove of occur and then you just don't do it, you know, you only focus on that and don't do any real work on yourself, then you're going to end up very unhappy. And since most likely many of these things aren't going to meaningfully change in a single generation, and given that many of the efforts done to try to change them are useless, quite honestly, that's ingredients to being a very unhappy person. So my suggestion is to think about that, to think about, you know, the things that you are doing. Obviously, they're important. You know, you have an important intent. You want to be free and you want others to be free, and that's a wonderful thing. However, I think in any pursuit, it's important to step back from it and to consider the real impact of it. And how you can optimize yourself. And there's always, like, you change one thing here, it changes something over there, you change something over there, it changes something here. Kind of like when I'm doing my standing meditation, like I relax my back and my belly gets tight, and then I relax my belly and my back gets tight, and I relax all that, and then my shoulders get tight, or I realize that there was tightness there all along, and then I let go of that. You know, there's just, it's a very complex system, you know, reality, you know, it's a very complex thing, you know. And I think we tend to oversimplify it. And we need to be able to think really clearly in order to not do that. You know, there's all these people like using things like Occam's razor, and they think, oh, just because it's the simplest explanation, it must be true. Well, that's not exactly true. Sorry, bud. Just because an answer, a theory is the simplest, doesn't mean it's true. Maybe it's more likely, doesn't mean it's true. So anyways, you know, this is a topic, you know, the ways that we're neutralized basically, either by design or by just our own incompetence, could fill books, you know, many books. What I would love to see is more diversity, is for people to still their minds and see the world really clearly, see what actually is, and not grasp so much onto particular movements and personas and things of that sort. Maybe enjoy those as if they were a raft that take you from one shore to another, but you get off the raft eventually. You don't stay on the raft. You can use those to help explore things, but if you attach to them too much, it's going to inhibit your progress. And I would love to just see more uniqueness, less celebritarians, less focus on certain individuals, because there's so much wonderful potential out there that if we weren't all trying to do the same bullshit that doesn't work usually, we might actually really create an interesting solutions. You know, it's kind of like the market. You know, if everybody is doing the same old shit, the cool things aren't going to be discovered. You know, like if everybody's just really set in their ways and they're all doing the same thing, you're not going to have somebody come out of left field and create a solution that just turns it all on its head and changes what everybody does to things that work better. Be nice if things that work better were tried. And things that were worse were tried too, of course, because you're going to get some of both as people try things. I certainly know from my own experience, I've done a lot of shit that's useless. I've wasted quite a bit of time. I've wasted time learning about useless shit. And in the process, I found some really cool shit. So I think it's been worth it, because you do have to have some time for waste. You're not just going to immediately find the best information and understand it and recognize its value. So yes, it's inevitable you're going to waste some time. And that's nothing wrong with that, as far as I'm concerned, at least. It's kind of something you really can't avoid. But what you can do is a little bit of introspection. And look at where you've been. And maybe think for a minute about how can you be free now, without anybody else having to do anything. Wouldn't that be great? Hey! To make now the freest time that can be. Goes back to my whole living in the present thing. You know, if we get caught up in all these these things that people do almost ritualistically at this point in time, the protesting and all this other kind of stuff, that's kind of like living in the future in many regards. But living free now, you know, like the peaceful parenting thing, for instance, you know, if I want to be free now, I can try to create the freedom in my home. Make it so that my kids are free. Make it so that I'm free. Obviously, it's going to be more work for me. So I do have to give up some of my freedom because, you know, like a lot of parents, I can't just go and spank my child whenever they're annoying me or they do something I disapprove of. But really, that would be one of those kind of trade-offs where, you know, you've got to create freedom in your inner circle, in your inner sanctum. You create that freedom, and ultimately, it does have a long-term payoff because your children don't grow up to be ass clowns. They don't grow up to be just degenerate ass clowns. Not that they necessarily have to if they're, you know, spanked and yelled at and all that kind of stuff. Sometimes they turn out just fine, or they seem to turn out just fine, and they deal with it. But, you know, if you don't turn your child into an ass clown, it sure does make a good chunk of their childhood much freer for everybody, and it makes it so you have a great relationship with them, and so that you have a lot more enjoyment and freedom to do what you want to do rather than having to deal with bullshit all the time. So that's a A-OK. That's the one celebritarian I really have, you know, a whole lot of interest in would be Stefan Molyneux, and I know a lot of people bitch at him over some of his theories and whatnot, but shit. You know, encouraging people to, very large numbers of people to not treat their kids like shit, I'd say that's an admirable goal, and that's actually something that could have profound impact on society in a very short period of time. I think it's really catching on, honestly. It's one of the few things that's actually catching on, is there's a lot of people my age who don't beat the shit out of their kids. What do you know? Now, many of them yell at their kids, but at least they're making some progress. And that's all we can really hope for, is a kind of sliding scale, incremental progress. Progress on ourselves, work on ourselves, become freer, freer in our homes, freer in our bodies, freer in our minds, have a calm, peaceful mind that can see the world for what it is, can recognize what it is, can then respond to what it is, and then can change and adapt constantly through introspection. So that's about all I've got today. I think I covered that about all that I really need to for now. I hope that you got something out of that, and enjoyed yourself, and good luck.